Harper Audio presents Drinking and Dating. P.S. Social Media is Ruining Romance by Brandi Glanville with Leslie Bruce, with an epilogue by my mom, Judy Glanville. This is Brandi Glanville. I dedicate this book to all the men I've loved before and to all the single people looking for love in this world. Keep hope alive, learn from my mistakes, and by all means, hashtag keep it sexy. Introduction, how to get screwed. Fuck me. Since I announced this follow-up book to Drinking and Tweeting, I've been asked countless times to describe what my second book will be about. I'm sure people have wondered what I could possibly have left to discuss after I freely aired all of the dirty laundry in my first book, from my husband's torrid affairs with cocktail waitresses, well-known actresses, hashtag my lips are sealed, and one country, minus the O, music singer, to my undergoing vaginal reconstructive surgery to make my kitty 17 again. The answer was simple. Drinking, dating, and occasionally medicating, and other ways I've gotten fucked. There are millions of ways to get screwed in this town, and I've experienced most of them. Learning that some douchebag wannabe talk show host that I went on one pity date with was selling completely false stories about me because not only was his career in the shitter, but I also refused to have sex with him is one. Getting pinned to the hood of a professional athlete's Porsche on a dark side street in Beverly Hills because neither one of us could wait the 15-minute drive to his house is another. I've never seemed to have a problem getting fucked, good or bad. Now don't go all reality TV crazy on me and pretend to be offended. Whether you're actually saying it or just thinking it, we've all been there, and it's not just a Hollywood problem. In today's world, you don't have to be in the spotlight to get screwed. Perhaps one night you have a few too many drinks at dinner and your friend posts a drunk-eyed photo of you on Twitter or Instagram, and all of a sudden all of your followers, including work colleagues and family, know you're a total lightweight. Some might even say that they're really, quotations, worried about you, which happens to be one of the most judgmental, condescending phrases ever, in my opinion. Or you're recently single and need to feel wanted and sexy again, so you call your ex-boyfriend in hopes that he'll drive out to wherever to help Stella get her groove back, only to realize that he's been constantly following you on social media for a month and demands answers to every single post you've written since you broke up with him, all the while pretending his friends sent him the post and he doesn't actually care. It's been 5 years now since my life was forever changed. It's been 5 years since I discovered my ex-husband was sleeping with half the women in Hollywood, and that everything I wanted to believe with absolute certainty about my life was so very wrong. I've been separated and then divorced for almost as long as I was married, which is a strange thing to even write. Sometimes it feels like just yesterday that my ex and my baby boys were snuggling on the couch with me in our gorgeous Calabasas home. Other times it feels like it was all a crazy dream I had one night a very long time ago. But I have three permanent reminders of my marriage that I live with every day. Mason, Jake, and HPV. My boys are the light of my life. Even if on my wedding day someone had a crystal ball revealing my future heartbreak and devastating divorce, I still would have walked down that aisle. These little fuckers were and always will be worth it. My HPV, on the other hand, was not. Statistics don't lie. Half of all sexually active Americans have HPV. Although most don't even know it, hashtag see your doctor. By age 50, 80% of all American women have contracted the virus, according to various reports. It's nice to know I'm not alone, but it still doesn't make getting my cervix scraped every 3 months any more fun. Reading stories online where people bash you for openly talking about having contracted the virus because you were foolish enough to believe your husband was faithful also isn't my idea of a good time. I went through hell and back, but I'm here, I'm breathing, and I'm still using wildly inappropriate language at the worst possible moments. Hashtag Brandi Blunders. I've embraced being a single mom and created a very happy life for my boys and me. I continue to make embarrassing mistakes all the time, and I still have a really poor knowledge of historical political figures. But I've always owned it. Hashtag duh. No more ex-husband to blame, no more horrible friends to make me feel bad, and no more 17-year-old vagina. See chapter 4, where I discuss one of the gorgeously well-endowed men I dated. My kitty's probably more like 23 now, which isn't horrible. Hashtag could be worse. And even when I am having the worst of days, like discovering that there were photos splashed everywhere of my black thong hanging out of my cream-colored dress because I had a few too many glasses of wine while out with friends and didn't anticipate a sea of paparazzi, I still wouldn't trade my life for anything. Side note, that also happens to be the dress I wore on the cover of my first book. Thanks, Alice and Olivia, for helping me with both the best and worst photo ops of my life. 5 years ago, I was a blindly happy Calabasas housewife who didn't know how to Google, tweet, or text. Hashtag, ignorance is bliss. I was just like any normal mom who read celebrity tabloid magazines at the grocery store checkout merely for entertainment and not to see if I was in any of them running my big mouth. Other than being the best mom and wife I could be and raising my children to become proper gentlemen one day, I had no real career or identity of my own. At that time, I had already achieved every goal I thought I wanted. Guess what? Life goes on after reaching MILF status. One of the few labels I actually welcome. Today, I'm no longer that gullible housewife. I just play one on TV. Thanks, Andy Cohen. Life has a funny way of working itself out. I've been in the public eye now for a few years, and while I definitely learned my fair share of lessons, like overly cross your legs yoga style when you get out of a car, never go outside without makeup, and always be nice to the paparazzi, there are some things I just won't get used to. For instance, I'll never enjoy learning incredibly private things about my personal life from the cover of a magazine. Hashtag Us Weekly. Of course, I might end up running my mouth about it later, but call me crazy, I'd just like to be the first to know. Last year, I discovered, much to my surprise, that I was an unfaithful wife. According to the report, I had sex with some guy in my family home 6 weeks after my second son was born. Really? 6 weeks? Now, as all of you ladies who have children know, doctors order at least that long before your kid is even ready for sex. Not to get all National Geographic, but I think it's more like 12. And seriously, who feels hot enough or confident enough about her body to sleep with a new partner a month and a half after she's had a child? At that point, you're probably too embarrassed to even have sex with your own husband, let alone some hot stranger. Oh, and not to mention that for the first 2 months, I had a house filled with a family, a round-the-clock baby nurse, and a full-time nanny, all the while dealing with postpartum depression. I mean, who comes up with this shit? Seriously, think about it. Who on earth would have anything to gain by leaking false information about an alleged affair 7 days before the tell-all book about my philandering ex and his mistress hit bookstores? You tell me. To top that, my affairs were apparently with former NBA player Rick Fox, who I don't believe I've actually ever met, and restaurateur Harry Morton. Knowing what I do know about what a sham my marriage was, I may have welcomed dating either one of these eligible bachelors, but it just wasn't true. Did I casually and frequently date before my divorce was finalized and my husband was already in a public relationship with another woman? Hell yes, I did. Did I ever have an affair before that? No, not ever. That's just not in my DNA. Hashtag for better or worse. I'll never get used to reading false claims about my personal life in the press, but I also appreciate the opportunities that being in the public eye has afforded me. It's what I signed up for and ultimately helped save my life. Only recently have I truly started putting myself out there again in the dating world with an open mind and, more importantly, an open heart. I needed time alone and time to find myself. I needed to figure out who the fuck I was. I had one serious relationship shortly after my divorce that opened my eyes and taught me how to have fun again, because apparently life does exist outside the valley after the age of 30. However, I mostly remained guarded and terrified of being hurt again. While opening my mind was a relatively easy task, you're about to find out I had a bit more trouble opening my heart. At 40 years old, going on 25, I was finally ready to be a single woman again. But I had zero idea what to expect. To put it quite simply, the game has changed. You heard it here first, folks. If you're like me and have recently re-entered the dating pool as a single parent and divorcee, you're in for a serious fucking wake-up call. Oh, you're married or in a long-term relationship and think that doesn't apply to you? Well, go fuck yourself. Knowing how to play the game, or that there even needs to be one, is just as important for keeping your partner as it is for landing him or her in the first place. Hashtag keep it sexy. After 13 years with the same man, I was finally off the bench and ready to play a few innings. First, I had to figure out what I wanted in a partner. I've always had a type: tall, dark, and handsome. Since my relationship with my ex turned out to be an absolute disaster, I figured that it was a good idea to cast a wider net. I decided no type of guy was off limits, except the taken ones, and adopted the mantra, yes is the new no. It's been a liberating experience. It's also gotten me into a little bit of trouble. Like, maybe don't say yes to skinny dipping on a public beach after your third glass of wine. Because of my new outlook, I've gotten to know some really amazing men and some pretty serious douchebags as well. My list of possible suitors ranged from 23 to 56 years old and was comprised of film directors, surfers, a felon, artists, D-list TV actors, real estate agents, and a few not-so-closeted gay men. And, gasp, even a couple movie stars. The next thing I needed to figure out was how to date in this technology-infused world. Of course, I knew that certain things would never change, like always keep your kitty cat fresh, never be too available, and just say no to booty calls. I mean, I was married to an actor for 8 years. I wasn't dead. But learning to date again now is a whole new animal, and I'm not just talking cougar. When I first discovered the benefits of technology and social media, I used it to obsess about my husband, his future wife, and our children throughout our breakup and divorce. Once I decided I was open to love again, I realized that technology is also a very powerful and dangerous tool. Gone is the time of the three-day rule. Hashtag so last century. Today, it's rare to actually pick up the phone and call someone. Even my own voicemail instructs callers, text me instead. My inbox is always full. Instead, we text, tweet, Facebook message, and whatever other social fucking media I choose not to know about. Hashtag, what the fuck is LinkedIn anyway? I'm still trying to figure out Twitter. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. And at 40, who still plays just the tip? Barely surviving my divorce taught me that health, happiness, and honesty are the key ingredients to any successful union. It may sound obvious, but only after you learn to accept and forgive your own flaws and shortcomings can you forgive those in another individual. Face it, people, no one is perfect. Only after you let go of the pain in your past can you have a future with someone new. Only after you've spent countless hours with some battery-operated bedroom toys can you fully direct your partner on what your exact needs are. And once you've conquered all of this, you're finally ready to share yourself, imperfections and all, with another person who will undoubtedly have just as many flaws of his or her own. So join me in this new, unpredictable adventure as I fumble through the dating world as a single parent, divorcee, reality personality, and just an unlucky gal who occasionally gets lucky. Who hasn't experienced a nip slip or two? I mean, it's not like I started my reality career with a sex tape. But after all, I wouldn't be me without my fair share of mistakes. At the better judgment of my publisher, agent, and mother, some of the names and details of certain people have been changed to protect the privacy of the innocent. And not so innocent. Here are a few of my favorite lessons learned. 1. Bathroom hookups are great ideas in theory, but a little less practical when there are cameras filming your every move. Hashtag R-H-O-B-H. 2. It doesn't matter how much money you have. Every woman gets wrinkly elbows eventually, and there's no such thing as knee lifts. Trust me, I've checked. Hashtag doctors know best. 3. You should never kiss and tell, especially when it's a really famous Scottish actor and you're on live television. Hashtag know when to plead the fifth. 4. Finally, when you write an entire country drop the O album about your affair with a married man, most people won't buy it. Hashtag just saying. Chapter 1. I survived. Now what? The Valley. Noun. 1. A northern suburban area of Los Angeles where white picket fences and pebble tech pools are synonymous with antidepressants, cheating spouses, and gossipy housewives. 2. The seventh ring of hell. Example. After the former actress abandoned all hope for her once thriving career, she resigned herself to living in the Valley. I finally made it. In Los Angeles, where you live is almost as important as who you know or who you're fucking. And my new home is in the ultra-swanky Bel Air neighborhood. You'll learn more later about who I've been fucking. After all these years, I was finally on the right side of Mulholland Drive, the iconic road that sits on the top of the Santa Monica Mountains and separates LA proper from...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.